Hi, this is Scott MacArthur, and this is an introduction to biohacking. In this little introduction, I'm going to take you through what is the current situation with a subject that I think is absolutely fascinating, and that is the subject of biohacking. I'm going to look at a definition of biohacking. I'm going to look at three or four of the different areas within the discipline that is called biohacking. And I'm going to end with giving you some ideas about what organisations might be able to do to utilise this developing technology in their businesses. So let's start by giving you a definition of biohacking. Now this is quite difficult because this is quite a new field. And to be honest, there are lots of definitions, but I've come up with one that I think will make sense to most of you. Biohacking is about managing one's own biology using a combination of medical, nutritional, and electronic techniques. So why do I think that biohacking is something that every organisation should be having a look at? We know today that the pace of change feels really difficult, really fast. Whether that's true or not, I'm not sure sometimes, but certainly with the amount of data and the amount of technology we're experiencing in our lives, I think there's a reasonable argument to say that today is the fastest that change has ever been in human history. But how that is framed is quite important, because although you might hear lots of people saying that, there's a way of framing it that I think makes it even clearer and actually makes understanding issues like biohacking even more urgent for organisations. If today is the fastest that change has ever been, that means that today is as slow as it will ever be again in history. Now, I'm sure you're aware of the fact that technology is growing at what they call an exponential rate. Now, forgive me if you know this, but I'm just going to spend a few seconds explaining what exponential actually means. Let's look at a classic example where you are taking a number of steps. This came from a chap called Ray Kurzweil. If you take 30 linear steps, that's the way we think linearly, 30 linear steps. If I start walking now for 30 steps, I will end up in my back garden. If, however, I take 30 exponential steps, I won't end up in my back garden. I will end up taking a billion steps. Now, I had some fun with that the other night, and I sat down and I did the average step length and how far a billion steps would be. And that would mean we could walk round the Earth 20 times if we took 30 exponential steps from where I am standing now. And that is the pace that technology is developing at. But what makes biohacking even more interesting, because we all know how complex and difficult it is to keep up with technology, biotech, and within that nanotechnology, etc., is actually growing, wait for it, at 3 times the speed of technology development. So the biology, the biotechnology that we now understand, is accelerating at a rate of 3 times that of what you may be familiar with in the technology world. That means that keeping abreast of this is very, very difficult. But I've got some ideas and I've got some tools that you might be able to think about in terms of what you could maybe do for your business. In addition to why I think biohacking is something that organisations should be looking at, in addition to the pace of development and the development of new tools in this field, is the fact that something is happening in society that I think is going to make the way we organise our organisations untenable in the near future. And that something is personalisation. We go into stores now and we expect to have the dress we want to buy specially made for us. We go into the coffee shop and we get our latte with our picture on the top. Things have been increasingly personalised. Then we go into the workplace, and our workplaces are ostensibly still designed the way they were just after the Industrial Revolution. We have standardised contracts, we have standardised ways of working, we have job descriptions, etc. I think only a fool will see that as the way organisations are going to look in the very near future. I don't think anyone is going to accept walking into a company, being told to forget all the personal things that they have from companies in their personal life, and to suddenly walk into collective bargaining. I think we have to change our attitude towards that. And I think that is one of the drivers behind why biohacking should be seriously considered by individuals and organisations alike. And the final reason why I think biohacking is something that you should be thinking about is it's not been thought about. This is something that's happening in plain sight. It's been happening for 20 years. You may have heard of Dolly the Sheep, or you may have heard of Bulletproof Coffee, or you may have heard of Fitbits. These are all part of the story. These things are happening almost without us noticing them. And I think that means that it's a great opportunity for early adopters to start thinking about what their strategy could be in relation to biohacking and how they could adopt that for themselves and their customers. Just before we get into this, I'd just like to give you a warning. Because this is a new way of thinking about biology and technology, etc., some organisations and some individuals have jumped on the bandwagon very early. And unfortunately, some of the things you'll see on the internet, if you Google it, you'll find lots and lots of different things. And a lot of them are actually without very much evidence. There is limited evidence to suggest that some of these things work. People are just jumping on a bandwagon and hoping that they will catch a wave of funding and public interest where they can then go off and sell their products to the market without them being tested. Now, I'm going to give you a way of hopefully avoiding that, or at least reducing susceptibility to that in your organisation. But just be aware of it. When you go on the internet, keep your mind open, but don't have it so open that your brain falls out. So let me introduce you to grinders. Grinders are individuals who are practicing modification, biological change on their own bodies. They call themselves cyborgs. They are looking for cybernetic devices to make them more effective as human-machine beings. It's fascinating because some of these individuals have created chips that can tell you where you are. So you've got your inbuilt GPS. There's one example where a person had put a chip into his ankle, and whenever he wants to know what direction he's going in, he can feel what way he is going, whether he's going north, south, east or west. Now, that might make you think, wait a minute, that's a bit peculiar. How can that work? Well, there's an odd thing that happens in the human brain. It's called plasticity. Now that means that we can respond to different things, and I'm not going to go into all the details about what plasticity actually means. But you have heard of Braille. This is how blind people see. They learn by touch, by touching little bumps and indentations on paper, and eventually with practice they can learn to read. And some of them say that is how I see. Now who would have predicted that we could see from the end of our fingertips? And that's the idea that the grinders put into place. They think, how can I enhance my senses by testing my brain's plasticity by exposing it with tools that extend the reach of our current famous senses? Very exciting, quite scary as well. And the way this is done in most individuals is with tattoo artists, because tattoo artists are already doing body modification, and when the grinders went looking for people to help them do the operations to put the cyborg implants in, they found that tattoo artists were there because they were the best, rather, because they already had the what they call aseptic technique, the clean techniques. They had the skills to actually help them implant devices into their bodies. This is not trivial. This is in multiple countries across the world, and people are playing with this technology to try and create new senses for human beings. They are called grinders. Next up, we have something called nutrigenomics. And this is where we use nutrition to hack or take control of human biology. And the key thing here is, it's not only to take control of the biology, it's to take control of human performance. And many of these drugs were actually developed in the military or in high performance athletics or sport, and they're quite scary, some of them, because they offer the opportunity to become stronger, to become bigger, to become superhuman. But at a human level, an ordinary person's level, these drugs, these nutrition supplements, etc., are not quite so dangerous or so scary. The collective name for these supplements and drugs is nootropics. Nootropics. And what nootropics do is they're the sci-fi smart drug or the cognitive enhancers that you might have heard of before. And the idea there is that they will improve the cognitive functions, how your brain works, particularly what they call the executive functions, which is about memory, creativity, motivation, and not in ill individuals, but in healthy individuals. And these ecstatic technologies have been used for many, many years. The German forces during World War II were famously using nootropics so that they didn't have to sleep every night. They could fight for 3 days. And during the Blitzkrieg campaign, which was very successful for Germany, one of the reasons they were successful was because their soldiers were able to stay awake for 3 days, whereas our soldiers had to sleep. So nootropics is an area that I find very interesting, but this is an area that also is very relevant to today's technology environment. One of the things that we all now experience every day is how difficult it can be to keep attention, to keep focused on what you're actually trying to do. And some of the nootropics promise to improve that function. They promise that they can improve your ability to focus on something. So it wouldn't surprise me in the next few years, given the level of investment from organisations in nootropics, if organisations started to think about, hold on, these nootropics are about performance. Companies need better performance. We need higher productivity. Could companies use these entirely legal supplements and drugs to improve business performance? Could we have in our organisations in the next 5 years a head of chemistry, or as I prefer to call it, a corporate apothecary? The third area I want to mention, just to make it clear, just so you can appreciate, this is something in clear sight. It's right in front of us. There is a whole movement just now called the quantified self movement. Now, if you've got a Fitbit or you've got an Apple Watch or any of these devices that measure your body functions, probably without knowing it, you are part of the quantified self movement. And this is where individuals are measuring various biomarkers and behaviours to try to optimise their health. It's also known as life logging. It's a cultural phenomenon at the moment. Who hasn't had a Fitbit for Christmas? Of self-tracking with technology, and has a community of users and makers of self-tracking tools who share an interest in self-knowledge through numbers. And then what happens is they monitor those numbers and they look how they can make tiny tweaks in the way they behave or the way they train or the way they think that can just give them an edge. You may have heard the famous Sky cycling team talking about marginal gains for little incremental improvements in efficiency and performance. So the quantified self phenomenon is part of the biohacking phenomenon. The fourth and final area that I would like people to be thinking about just now is what's called DIY biology. This is perhaps the most frightening part, or at least initially it's the most frightening part of the biohacking phenomenon. This is not the first time this type of behaviour has happened. In the late 70s and the early 80s, we're all familiar with the stories about Microsoft and Apple and how they started their huge organisations, their transformational technologies in garages. Today, those garages are full of biologists. Those garages are full of people who are looking at how they can manipulate the human genome or the human body for better performance. Now, many of them have started with animals and plants. So we have people working mainly in the show animals like dogs and horses, but also in areas where they use basic, what they call vector animals like rats and mice, where they're practicing the insertion of DNA from one animal to another. And in one terrifying example, one experimenter in a garage in America with no biological training bought a kit on Amazon. It cost him less than $300. Have a look. They're called CRISPR kits. CRISPR kits. And they're on Amazon for less than £200. He bought one of these kits. He moved a glowworm's DNA from a glowworm, the part that makes it glow, into rats. and the baby rats glowed at night. That's not science fiction, that actually happened. There are other organisations that are doing it in probably a slightly more interesting way, where one particular company is looking at a revolution. And what their aim is to replace all streetlights in the world. Replace all streetlights. And the way they're proposing to do that is by growing a tree that glows at night. Now that might sound ridiculous, but they are well down the road. They have already developed plants that glow at night, and they think that these trees will be available and on the market within 5 years. This is an interesting area. Note to this, and something that I find interesting, but also hopeful. In this DIY biology area, the practitioners have actually started to form groups. They've actually started to work together and collaborate across the world. And even more than that, and they've done something that not even conventional science has achieved, they've actually developed a code of ethics under which they will do their experimentation. Now, there are outliers like the professor who did experiments on children in China, but he was very quickly removed from the world of biohacking. He was seen as someone who was not performing to the right ethical standards. So although today this might sound quite scary, and this might sound like something you do not want your company to even think about, I think the way it is developing, and remember what I said at the beginning, it's growing at such a rate that companies should keep an eye on this and start to think about what their approach could be to biohacking. The first thing, and it might seem ridiculous, but I think it's pretty obvious, I have to confess here, my background is as a scientist, and I was a research biologist for many years. As you can see here, this is me when I was 23 with my former assistant Amanda. And I think that biology is becoming so important that companies should start to think about, where's our biological expertise? The interesting thing about this, as you can see from this graph, this was research done by a New Scientist. This need for biological skills seems to be here already, and organisations are already snaffling up biologists with biological skills. This is really fascinating, and I would love to think that in 5 years' time, even engineering firms will have heads of biology, and we'll be starting to talk about bioengineering as the next step in our organization's developments. And my final point here is, one of the driving forces behind this biological revolution, this biohacking development in the marketplace, is of course, like every other area at the moment, is data. And our organizations are doing better and better all the time at producing people analytics. We're better at managing human capital. We're having a better understanding of how our people are. I would like to see that reframed in organizations, moving from people analytics for analytics for people. I think we should start to think about the individual's data and then respond to that individual's data in terms of how they touch the organisation, how they touch policy, how they touch process, how their career may develop, how they may develop. I think there's a huge opportunity there which will respond to that personalisation development in the marketplace and give companies a fighting chance of keeping that talent within their organisation for much, much longer. Finish with some recommendations. This book here, Stealing Fire, by a chap called Stephen Kotler, is an excellent introduction to how nootropics specifically and some of the areas around fitness and health could be brought into organisations. So I'd recommend that. Now it is on the edge, so not all of this will prove to be true, but nevertheless it's exciting and quite interesting. Another recommendation would be if you pop over to YouTube and tap in this chap's name. His name is Jason Silva, and he has a YouTube channel called Shots of Awe. Now, if you can get over the delivery style, which is quite, how would I put it, quite American, he's quite over the top, big bang, wow, big flashy lights, etc. He actually quite brilliantly explains how we're seeing this convergence of biology, technology, and engineering to form a real opportunity for organisations. Thank you for listening to this introduction to biohacking and the interesting things that could come from this. And I'll finish with this. your brain and your organization's brain is ready for new plugins. Good luck, and thank you very much for listening.